Hello everyone and welcome to the session called Introduction to NLP. So my name is Yasmin Shelly. I work as a data engineer. I graduated last year as a computer science and applied mathematics engineer, and now I work as a data scientist and data engineer here in Tunis, Tunisia. So before we start discussing the topic of NLP, I would like to give you all a brief introduction about AI. So AI, or artificial intelligence, refers to the simulation of human intelligence in machines that are programmed to think like humans and mimic their actions. So the concept of AI was actually introduced by Alan Turing in the 1950s. He was actually the one to propose the question, can machines think? And if you guys know the movie The Imitation Game, I'm sure you know his story by now. He actually introduced many of the central concepts of AI in a report called Intelligent Machinery. So this is not a new field. Research in AI actually started decades ago. However, back then they did not have our advanced technology and our computers, so much of the research actually stayed on paper until recently. So if we want to briefly introduce AI, let's imagine that we have lots of data, a black box, and we want to use them to generate a result automatically. So after this black box will be giving this data, he will learn automatically how to generate this result. Now we must state that our data can be anything. It can be images, sounds, videos, numbers, texts, etc. What we do is that we transform our data into matrices and vectors, and we feed it to this black box that is actually a form of a mathematical function that can distinguish and learn from this data. This is actually the easiest way to understand AI. If you're still new to this field, I encourage you to see all fields of AI, all the aspects of AI, so that you can understand it better. But for now, we're going to focus on natural language processing. And what is natural language processing? So natural language processing is an aspect of AI that can help computers understand, interpret, and utilize human language. It can help them understand the context and intentions of humans, and therefore communicate more efficiently. NLP actually draws from several disciplines, including computer science and computational communications. Now, as you all know, we actually use NLP applications in our everyday life. I'm sure you are all familiar with chatbots, whether it's Siri, Amazon Alexa, or Google Assistant. We now have chatbots thanks to NLP. We all use Google Translate, whether to translate something or sometimes to just check if our spelling is correct. So yeah, Google Translate is actually built based on natural language processing. And if you all noticed, nowadays when we are using our messaging apps or when we are emailing someone, we now have the option of autocomplete. So while we are writing, we actually get suggestions from the app on how to finish the sentence. This is actually another form of an NLP application. And we all heard of sentiment analysis or spam filtering and speech recognition. These are all NLP models and NLP applications in real world that we use every day. So you may wonder, how can we actually start building an NLP model? Well, we have to go through a form of a pipeline to make an NLP model. We start by getting the data, and by getting the data, we need clean and structured text data. We can get data actually from many sources. We can buy databases, we can scroll websites, we can even gather the data manually. There are many forms to get data nowadays. And then we need to pre-process the data, meaning we need to clean this data and put it in a form that is later trainable by a model. Then we go by the step of modeling and testing the data, meaning that now we are going to give our data to this black box or this model, and then test if this model is really trained well and he can generate good results or not. And then, of course, the final step is actually deploying the model. Today, we're not going to talk about the first and the last step. We're just going to talk about the steps of pre-processing the data, and we're going to discuss a little bit about the types of NLP models, etc. But I thought you guys should have like the global vision. So first, we're going to start talking about data pre-processing, and it's basically us trying to find an appropriate representation of our textual data. So data pre-processing or text pre-processing is basically finding an adequate representation of our text by transforming our sentences into separate words that we call tokens and then into vectors. So let's see the sentence here today. Hi there, how are you doing today? Each word of this sentence will be changed into a number and together they form a vector. But before we talk about making this kind of transformation, we also must look at our sentences and clean them well. Meaning, first of all, our sentence must all have the same casing. It all must be either lowercase or it all must be uppercase. Second of all, we need to remove noise. If we have any type of noise in our sentences and our data, we need to remove it. Noise can be like misspellings, numbers, punctuations, etc. If we have certain characters in our sentences that do not serve the general purpose of the context of the sentence, then it's very useful to remove them before transforming our data into vectors. Also, we must insist on removing punctuation if possible. But if the punctuation actually serves the context of the sentence, then we can leave it. Other steps of text cleaning include stop word removal. And if you don't know what stop words mean, stop words are frequently used words in the English language or any type of language. These are words that have high frequency in any sentence we see. So because they have these high frequencies, they do not actually help us distinguish sentences from each other. So what we try to do is that we remove these words from our sentences, from our textual data, ahead before giving this data to the model. And there is, of course, a step of text normalization, especially if the data you have is crawled from the web, like from any messaging app or from Facebook. It is very probable that you will find words written like this in like Facebook language. So it's very important that you transform and normalize these words in order to have words that actually exist in the English dictionary. Also, very two important steps of text cleaning or text pre-processing are called lemmatization and stemming. Of course, we cannot do these two steps at the same time. We must choose to either do lemmatization or either do stemming. Lemmatization is basically stripping the word to its origin. For an example, if we have words like trouble, troubling, troubled, and troubles, when we lemmatize these kind of words, then they all become trouble. And stemming is the same thing, however, the stripping the word in stemming is very different from stripping it in lemmatization. Because when we strip words in lemmatization, we conserve the meaning of the word. The word does not get transformed into a word that does not exist in a dictionary. In stemming, however, when we strip the word, it's very probable that the word does not that the word is transformed into a word without a meaning. For example, if we stem the word trouble, it's very different from lemmatizing the word trouble. Of course, you cannot do both of these at the same time, so you must choose one operation to do. And this step in data cleaning or data pre-processing is not really necessary, but it depends on the context of your problem. So now that we cleaned our text and talked about the steps needed to clean our text and remove noise from it, let's talk a little bit about how we can transform it into vectors. The first method, or the most primitive method known in the NLP community, is called making a bag of words, where you take the data and represent the words based on their frequency in the document. Or when we say document, it means the initial data. This is a very simple method to understand and implement. However, this method usually leads to high dimensional feature vector due to the large size of the vocabulary. It also doesn't leverage co-occurrence between words. It just assumes that all the words are independent of each other. And it also can lead to sparse vectors. However, nowadays, there are more sophisticated approaches called making word embeddings, which gives a good textual representation. These word embeddings are generated using pre-trained embedders. Embedders are actually open source tools that are used to generate these kind of textual representations in smaller dimensional data. And the best part is that they are trained so that they can generate similar embeddings for similar words. And by similar, I don't mean words that are approximate to each other in sentences, but words that are similar in meaning. For an example, when you generate embeddings using an embedder for a cat or a kitten, these two words are very similar. The embedder is basically telling you these two words are synonyms. So now that we have discussed all the ways that we can use and the methods that we can use to clean our text and generate its representation, let's talk about the third step and the most important one, which is data modeling. So here we're going to talk about what kind of tasks do NLP models perform. Of course, we're not going to mention all the tasks. We're just going to mention three tasks, and it's for you to search and learn more about the other tasks. But we're just going to mention the three most important tasks in NLP. So one of the tasks is actually sentence classification. This is one of the simplest NLP tasks with a wide range of applications, including document classification, spam filtering, and sentiment analysis. So let's take the example of a spam classifier. The classifier is our black box, or whatever we want to consider it. We have lots of email data, and we know which data is considered spam and which data is considered valid emails. So we give our classifier this batch of data, and we actually tell the classifier which is which. And our intention from this is for the classifier to learn how to classify the spam data from the non-spam data by itself. So now if we take another email that the classifier never saw, never learned, and we give it to the classifier, based on the features of this new email, the classifier can tell us if this email is a spam or not. And this is a very simple task in NLP. It really has a wide range of applications, and it's very used today. So the second task is actually called entity recognition, and it's one of the tasks that I worked on, and trust me, this task is not easy at all. It is actually the task of identifying and categorizing information or entities in text. So an entity can be anything. It can be any word or series of words that consistently refers to the same thing. Let's look at this paragraph we have in here. For an example, here we have the word 3, 1, 45%, etc. All of these, like 3 and 1, they represent cardinals. So cardinal for us is an entity. Let's take also 2017, 2018, 2024. The entity recognizer can actually recognize that these are dates in the paragraph. And entity recognizers really do have a wide range of applications as well. They are most used in chatbots. So if you ever talk to a chatbot and you tell him that your favorite color is blue, and he like answers you back telling you that blue is looks great on you or something like that, it's most likely because the chatbot understands that blue is a color. And this is a really, really cool NLP model that we can use today. So, and the third task we're going to talk about today is called sequence to sequence. Sequence to sequence learning is about training models to convert sequences from one domain to sequences to another domain. For an example, this is very used in machine translation. Sequence-to-sequence models are often also called encoder-decoder models. These models basically take one sentence and convert it to another sentence. It can take one sentence from one language and convert it to another sentence to of another language, from, let's say, English to French, for an example. And it can be used in tasks more than translation. It can be used, for an example, to summarize text, to take paragraphs, long paragraphs, and transform them into shorter sentences. So now that we have discussed all the tasks that NLP models can perform, let's talk a little bit about what these models or what these mathematical functions are. So the most popular supervised NLP machine learning algorithms today are support vector machine, Bayesian networks, and of course, the most popular and most used algorithms are the neural networks or the deep learning networks, and it's what we're going to discuss after this. So, deep learning models are not any regular machine learning models. They are the best type of models to use to solve any kind of machine learning AI problem. And in NLP, there are specific type of models that are used, and we're going to look through them one by one today. So convolutional neural networks are, or CNNs, are basically just several layers of convolutions with nonlinear activation functions like ReLU. These kind of networks are most commonly used in computer vision, meaning in image classification or image detection. However, they can also be applied to natural language processing. How it works in NLP is that instead of image pixels, the model takes the sentence vectors or sequences. So in computer vision, these models have filters or layers, and they slide over local patches of an image. But in NLP, the filters or layers are used over full rows. Thus, the width of the layer must be the same width of our input sentence or our input matrix, as you can see in this graph right here. However, this deep learning model trains on words based on their proximity in sentences. And finding words close to each other doesn't necessarily mean that they are similar. And this is a major drawback for using CNNs in NLP. Now, the second type of model we are going to discuss is called RNNs, or recurrent neural networks, which is a type of artificial neural networks which uses sequential data or time series data. Using RNNs in NLP makes much more sense. Their mechanism resembles how we process language reading sequentially from left to right. An RNN treats each token of a sentence as a separate input occurring at time t. The architecture you see below is called a many-to-many RNN architecture. This is actually the type of architecture that we use in translation tasks. So it's important to know that there are many types of RNNs. There is the many-to-one, which is used in classification tasks. There is the one-to-many, which is used, for an example, in music generation, where you give the first note as input and the model generates the rest of the symphony or the rest of the note sequence. And there is the famous many-to-many, or the encoder-decoder RNN architecture, which is used in translation or sequence-to-sequence tasks. It's also important to note that there are different types of RNN cells. The traditional RNN, which is a very simple cell, there is the long short-term memory cell, or the LSTM cell, and there is the gated recurrent units, or the GRUs. These concepts are a bit advanced for an introduction, but if you are starting to learn NLP, you must tell the difference. So I encourage you to search each type of cell and study them. The most known and frequently used type of RNN is called the LSTM architecture. Now, of course, LSTMs and RNNs are very well known in NLP. They actually give really good results. And that was until a new approach was recently invented. This approach is called the self-attention mechanism. It was proposed in a paper ironically called Attention is All You Need in 2018. So this is actually a very, very new technological innovation. This paper actually proposed a special encoder-decoder model, or a special sequence-to-sequence model, that uses a self-attention mechanism, and this model is called transformers. This is what a bidirectional transformer language understanding, or a BERT, looks like. So transformers are, as I said, a novel sequence-to-sequence architecture based on a self-attention mechanism that is believed to be particularly well suited for language understanding, and it performed very well. It actually performed way better than any type of RNNs out there, which actually inspired a lot of memes calling that LSTMs are dead and long live transformers. But yeah, transformers actually triumphed, and nowadays they are the most recommended, most used NLP models out there. They are very delicate and heavy to understand. And I recommend, if you are trying to get into NLP, I would definitely recommend starting by understanding RNNs and LSTMs first before moving on and working or understanding transformers. And if you wonder why this type of model actually became the best type of model to use in NLP, well, it's thanks to the attention mechanism. Transformers can actually capture dependencies between words in long sentences. This is an example here. Actually, in this paragraph, if you look at this paragraph, for us, it's easy to see the relationship between the highlighted words. However, in LSTMs and in traditional deep learning models, it's very hard to to understand these type of connections. So we reached the end of our presentation. Let's conclude. So NLP actually represents a very promising field, thanks to the large amount of textual data on the internet. I think text data is probably the largest type of data out there. It's very promising because it also can help us ease communication, which is a huge need nowadays, and it can also automate certain tasks such as customer service. However, it does have a little bit of obstacles. In order to develop NLP models, it's not enough to have large amounts of data. We also have to have a good quality data, and unfortunately much of the data that we have right now is poor quality. The second major challenge in NLP is distinguishing contextual ambiguity in certain languages. It's very hard to distinguish context in certain languages. We can, like, for an example, the Tunisian language is very hard. It's very ambiguous. We can use two opposite words next to each other, and they can mean an entire different thing. So contextual ambiguity is a huge challenge in NLP. That's it for our presentation. Thank you for listening to me today, and I will be happy to listen to all of your questions. Thank you.